Okay, so now we're ready to start. Welcome to any late joiners. My name is Michael from the Department of Mechanical Engineering. I do communications, marketing, and events. And if you were to choose engineering as a discipline you want to follow, which is an amazing, exciting, and very varied set of disciplines, and if you wanted to choose mechanical engineering, which is really, really challenging, but opens so many doors and has such challenging and interesting tasks within it, including robotics, propulsion, biomedical engineering, all sorts, as you can explore through the Spring into STEM series that we're having here at UCL Engineering. Then if you decide to join, apply to UCL or make it to UCL, which is not easy, but certainly doable if you work hard, then you might meet him on campus. Today, we're talking about soft robots and hard problems. And I have the great pleasure of introducing my colleague, Dr. Helge Wurdemann, who will take you through the presentation. So I hope you enjoy this.
Thank you very much, Michael, for the nice introduction. Welcome, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening from wherever you are joining us today. And it's a pleasure to me to be talking about robotics today. I'm an associate professor of robotics in mechanical engineering. And within mechanical engineering, I'm leading my lab, my group of people, which is called the Soft Haptics and Robotics Lab. And we are living in very strange times, so it's a shame I cannot meet you in person, but it of course gives us a bigger opportunity to reach out to all of you wherever you are. And in order to break the ice a little bit, I have prepared a few Mentimeter questions. So how this works will be on my slide, on my next slide. So you will see here a question that I posted on menti.com. And if you can use your phone, for instance, to go onto menti.com and insert the code here at the very top, you will be able to access this. And it would be great if you can let me know where in the world you are and from where you are joining this event. And we can look at our distribution. So let's see who will be able to go to menti.com and insert this code. And if you can let us know from where you're joining, that would be fantastic. So we can get a idea where you are. So if anyone could do this, then we can immediately see the results. If you go to menti.com, okay, thank you very much for submitting. So you have submitted it and it's not visible. That's always a little technical problem. But I'm sure that we will fix it. I apologize for that. And I think we will see the results in a second. So thank you very much. So I can see that some of you are in London, but many of you are also in Asia. And we can also see that some of the continents we have not been able to reach out to, but it's good to see a very good distribution among the world. That's very nice. So thank you very much for this. Then we have another question that I asked. So this is the second question. So how do you feel today? So the answers are just loading here. If you put in some words. Okay, excited. That's very good. Good. Fine, I guess. Sleepy. I believe that is either in the morning or someone in the evening. Curious. Fantastic. Motivated. But I think excited is the word to take away from that. That's very good. And I don't know why I cannot press the next here. But then I just exit my screen and go to the next slide where I feel, how do you feel about this event today? Are you excited? Are you ready to learn something new? Or are you a little bit nervous about all of this? Fantastic. Strongly agreed with excitement and learning, not so nervous. That's very good. And unfortunately, I cannot press next, but I will figure that out. So before we go into the work that we are doing in soft robotics, I would like to first discuss a little bit what actually robotics is. And many of you might have heard the word robotics, heard about robotics. You probably, and I hope you can hear my screen sound, that many of you have probably seen these type of movies. For instance, iRobot. iRobot, in fact, was a movie from, I think, 2004, which is an American science fiction action movie, which is actually based on a screenplay by Winter, which is called Hardwired. And more about this later on in my lecture. But some of you might have also seen this movie.
His name is Wally. That's all.
Exactly. So this is the movie, the film Wally, which was launched in 2008. It's a computer animated movie about a robot that is left behind on the Earth to collect and sort garbage. And it's also a love story in a way, because Wally will meet another robot called Eve. But let's dive into a little bit of history and understand, in fact, where the word robot has been originated from. So if you can go back to your smartphone devices, and let me know what you think, when was the first time the word robot was used. So if you go back to menti.com and then you put in the code at the very top of the slide, 13867898. And what do you think, when was the first time that the word robot was used? And what was the profession of the person who, in fact, introduced this word? So was it about 50 years ago? Was it 100 years ago, or even 200 years ago? What are your thoughts? Okay, many of you think it was 100 years ago. It's very interesting. Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts on this. And the other questions that I ask is, of course, what was the profession of the person who introduced the word robot? So if we, sorry about this. I don't know why this just happened, but I share my screen, so. Okay. So I think there's also a very good trend here. A lot of you think that it was a writer. And in fact, you're absolutely right. It was about 100 years ago when Carol Capet was introducing the word robot. And it is coming from the Czech language. And the name robot means worker or servant. So this was, in fact, in a book, in a play. And the play begins in a factory. And this factory makes artificial people. And these artificial people are called robots. And all these robots are, in fact, made from synthetic material. They are living among other humans that are made by real flesh and blood. But they are, of course, different. And in fact, some of them are mistaken for humans and can think for themselves. But of course, at one point, they don't seem to be very happy to work for the humans. And then the issues are starting. In 1942, roughly, then, a professor of biochemistry, Isaac Asimov, then defined the three laws of robotics. And so he started a short story called Runaround, and which is included into his book, I, Robot. And he defined these three laws of robotics, and robots and artificial intelligence, they don't need to inherently contain or obey these three laws. But the humans who create these robotic devices, they must choose to program them in a way to obey these laws. And these three laws are: a robot may not injure a human being, or through inaction allow a human being to come to harm. A robot must obey the orders given to it by human beings, except when such orders would conflict with the first law. And the third law is that a robot must protect its own existence as long as such protection does not conflict with the first or the second law. The screenplay, then, by Jeff Winter, is from the story by Winter himself, and is based on the original screenplay, Hardwired, which is then basis for the movie I, Robot, that you have seen in the very beginning of my presentation. But what is robotics in an engineering way? So here you can look into a definition from the 1970s, the late 1970s, from the Robot Institute of America. And there it is written that a robot is a reprogrammable, multifunctional manipulator designed to move material, parts, tools, or specialized devices through variable programmed motions. And this is a very important part, as you can see in a second, for the performance of a variety of tasks. And the three main columns of what a robot, the three primitives of robotics can be summarized with act, sense, and think, reason. And let's have a look at these three circles here. So first at the circle act. You probably know, for instance, washing machines or dryers. These are machines that some of them do not have sensors integrated. They are just executing when you press a button. For instance, when you want to wash your clothes, you insert them into the washing machine, you press the button, you set a time, and after the time, the machine will stop. The machine will not stop, of course, when the clothes are cleaned. So there's no measurement of how clean your clothes are, but rather than the timing will tell the machine when to stop. But of course, we can add sensors to these machines. These can be different type of sensors. We have here a video, a symbol of a video camera, so we can have some imaging or image processing then, some voice, some timing as well, some distance, forces, etc. And when you look into machines like vehicles and you equip these with vehicles, then you can build a car that can park automatically based on distance sensors, for example, ultrasonic sensors. Now, the third part of a robotic device is the brain, the artificial brain or the artificial intelligence. So the data that is collected from the sensors are then processed by an algorithm. For example, nowadays a lot of people use machine learning. And then based on the algorithms, some action will be returned. And this will be then given to the machine, and the machine will execute these actions. So you can see that a robot nicely integrates action, sensing, and thinking or artificial intelligence. So let me ask you another couple of questions. And the first question here is, what was the application for the first robot? So where was the first robot effectively installed? So if you can go back to Menti and put in the code at the very top, and then answer what you think the first application for a robot was. Was it in the automotive industry, military, surgery, or agriculture? Okay, quite a few thoughts there. Almost an equal number of people think that the first robot was going into the automotive industry or military or agriculture, but now agriculture is heading here. That's very interesting. And unfortunately, I cannot advance my slides without going out of the presentation mode. But let's have a look at the second question. When was the first industrial robot developed? I see. So the 1940s and the 1950s are heading. Very good. So let's have a look at the first industrial robot. And I hope you can hear the sound as well.
This is Movie Turn. Leslie Mitchell reporting. A robot for industry.
So you can see here, usually when I hear the sound at the introduction to a film that starts similar to this, I'm going to switch the TV channel because I know now there will be a black-white movie coming, which is very old, but I hope you all stay with me here. The first robot was in fact developed in the 1950s. It was designed by George Devol, and he called it Unimate. And that then formed the company name later on, Universal Automation. And this first robot was actually deployed into the automotive industry, in fact, for General Motors. We at UCL Mechanical Engineering have also a quite long history of robotics. In fact, robotics started at UCL in the 1970s. When a research assistant called Edward started building this sculpture in our labs. And here you can see a photo that was taken in the sub-basement of the Roberts Engineering Building at UCL Bloomsbury in the structures lab, where he built this sculpture in a way. And you can see nicely how some actuators are integrated at the top here to then move the entire structure. And this was actually happening from 1971 to 1986. And here you can see also a recent documentary about the sculpture. So here you see the end effector, the tip of the manipulator of the structure, and the tip would then navigate among people, and people will interact with the robot, and the robot will then sense this interaction and engage in a way with the human. So this was essentially human-robot collaboration or human-robot interaction. And here you see some footage when it was in fact exhibited at a museum in Eindhoven. So robotics has started at the university for many years. And of course, the way that robots are built has changed a lot from that time. So here you can see, for instance, that the design is more agile, they are smaller, but essentially very similar. So you have here a number of joints and links that are built in series. And then there are some vision cameras, usually mounted, in this case, at the top probably, that track, in this case, the ping pong, the table tennis ball, and then the robot will process all this data and eventually action how to respond to the ball there. There are different types of robotic devices. So in this case, there are robotic drones. They can also have sensors on boards tracking objects and then reacting, as you can see in this case. You might have seen on YouTube also the latest versions of bipedal or humanoid robots, as you can see here from the company Boston Dynamics. Of course, mechanical engineering design, computation make it possible that we create robotic devices that can execute complex tasks such as the ones that you see in this video. And then there are, of course, also robots that have multiple legs, as you can see in this video. And there are many of them, of course, developed around the world. And it is thanks to the researchers that these robots become more and more autonomous and can then execute tasks entirely autonomously. And then another field where robotics and autonomous systems advance more and more are autonomous vehicles, as you can see here. So this is a company called RoboRace, one of the first autonomous racing cars. In fact, one of our graduates has been working or is still working for this company as a leading the design team. And possibly an autonomous vehicle is one of the robotic devices that the majority of humans in the world will have a direct interaction with, because it's estimated that we very much move towards autonomous vehicles in the near future. But of course, there are many challenges left, as you can see from this video here. This is a video from the DARPA challenges. This is an American competition that is organized every few years, And during that time, they called for research teams to compete with humanoid robots executing a number of tasks. And you can see, of course, this is a video of failures that are happening. There have been also many successful executions of tasks, but you can see that there are many failures still happening. And we as engineers and researchers will need to continuously think of ideas and implement solutions to successfully execute some of these challenges. So there's a number of applications for robotics. In general, robotics is implemented when jobs are dangerous for humans. So, for example, in the nuclear industry, where nuclear waste needs to be recycled, then there are areas where repetitive jobs would need to be replaced with robots because they are boring, stressful, or labor-intensive for humans. An example is in the automotive industry, the welding robots, or, of course, tasks that humans eventually do not want to do anymore. And there might be an example of harvesting. When you have a lot of strawberries, for instance, that needs harvesting, which is very monotone for humans. So you can see that there are different motivations why robots would be deployed and replace humans in the future. And some of the application areas you can see here on the right-hand side. The work that we are doing in my lab is very much motivated by or inspired by this movie, which is Big Hero 6. So we are doing work in the area of soft robotics. Soft robotics is very different from traditional robots because our robots are not made out of metal, hard material, or aluminium, or ceramics, but we are using flexible soft materials such as different silicon materials or fabric, and we are building robots that can be actuated in this case with air, so pneumatic actuation or hydraulic actuation. And then we believe that these robots are in fact inherently safe in collaboration with humans. So I'm running the soft haptics at the robotics lab, and we look at different applications in healthcare robotics, collaborative robots where humans are working closely together with robots, and autonomous vehicles, in fact. And we are looking how is the human driver, who needs to be partially inside the car for some parts of the journey, interacting with the autonomous vehicle. And I would like to go into a little bit more detail about this topic and the work that we are doing within the world of autonomous vehicles. So autonomous vehicles have been researched for many years, for about 100 years now. The first experiment started in the 1920s, but I want to really make you look into a video that was published by GM, General Motors, in the 1950s about their prototype Firebird. And the Firebird is an electronic guide system that can rush it over an automatic highway while the driver relaxes. So let's have a look at this video.
We're all set for auto control.
And you can see...
Roger, Firebird 2. Move to electronic control strip in center lane.
So you can see how the man at the tower is guiding the driver to shift from...
Synchronize your speed and direction.
From Check. Manual control
into speed first.
An higher level of autonomy. And you can see the word autopilot is used very similar to what Tesla is using at the moment.
For well done, Firebird 2.
Autopilot.
You're now system. Under automatic control. Hands off steering.
But of course, in reality, this is not implemented at the moment. So we do not have a human in the tower that can nicely guide a driver to go from manual to autonomy or vice versa, but instead the machine has to communicate with the human driver. And that can be, in fact, quite dangerous. So at the moment, there are different autonomy levels. Level zero is, of course, where the human is having full control. The hands and the eyes are on the road and on the steering wheel and very much driving the entire vehicle. And then there are different levels of autonomy, up to autonomy level four. A human driver needs to be sitting on a seat, and the human can switch on or switch off a number of technologies that are embedded in the car to go from level one to level two to level three and vice versa. In general, the cars that are commercially available at the moment, they would go up to level two. And let's have a look how this is then implemented, for example, in a vehicle, and in this case, a Tesla vehicle. So you can see here the driver's hands and the steering wheel and a close-up view of the dashboard here. And you can see this little item here, which is marked blue, which means that the autopilot is on. And you can see now that depending on the road condition, the sensory information, the car switches very quickly between driving autonomously or driving manually. So you can see this is now off. The driver tries to switch it on. It does not work. And in between, the driver was not switching it off, but the car itself was switching it off. So these are very, very unsafe transitions between a higher autonomy level and a lower autonomy level. And this can be very dangerous. So there have been many of these fatal accidents reported in the media, of course. And in fact, there are reports that are gathered by each state. For example, in this state in California, where incidents were happening that were incidents because of a unsuccessful takeover request from the vehicle. So in this case, the Tesla was driving behind another vehicle. So the vehicle was in white, was driving behind another vehicle. There were one faded road line here, and the other one was very much visible to the vehicle. And eventually the vehicle was guided along this visible white line, and of course then crashed into a barrier. Another YouTuber then was driving with his Tesla onto the same way. And you can see here the video that he was taking. And you can see eventually that one of the lanes is fading. So you can see this is fading, and the vehicle wants to orient itself onto the other lane and would have eventually crashed. So you can see here how the vehicle is then switching off the autopilot system without any notification happening. And you can see this, in fact, in the National Transportation Safety Board report that says that there was an unsuccessful transition. So what we do in our research here is we are looking into how can we deliver safe transitions from the car being in control to the driver to be in control. And there we do experiments where we have human drivers that have these caps, that wear these caps. So these are called EEG sensors. They understand the brain activity. And then we use glasses that can record the eye movement of a driver. And based on this, we will understand what we call the situational awareness of a driver. And if the driver is not aware of the situation, then we use feedback systems, not only visual or audio feedback, but touch feedback, and we call this also haptic feedback, in order to encourage and promote situational awareness. So what we have done here is we have developed a number of actuators, and one of the examples you can see here. And these actuators are made out of silicon material. Inside the silicon material, we use the same foam that you find in a driver seat, essentially, of a car. And here we are proposing pneumatic actuation. So we at the top, we have an inlet for air actuation, and at the bottom, water actuation. So when we actuate this robot, we can at the same time vary how much air or water is going into this this robot. So then we built the entire actuation system. So here you can see two syringes. One is for water actuation, the other one for air actuation. This is then interfaced with some motors here, stepper motors, and then microprocessors. And so we can then drive the little actuator that you can see here. And here you can see some of our experimental setup. So to understand how much height this robot can execute, what the stiffness will be, etc. And then essentially we gather different type of curves. And the nice thing about these actuators are that because we use water and air, we can change how stiff the robot will become. Because in air, you can imagine air can be compressed. But of course, if you look into hydraulic actuation, you can exert a lot more forces. And eventually, we have then integrated a number of these actuators, you can see here nicely, into a driver seat that you can then see here. And unfortunately, you cannot feel it, but you can imagine how it might feel when you get different actuation. So there are also some at the very top and at the bottom. And now what we do as a next step is we are putting this into a driving simulator. So we're looking at accidents that happened in the real world. They are reported in a document by the state of California. And we can see what was happening at what time with the autonomous car and what the human did. And we reproduce these driving scenarios. And instead of using audio or visual feedback, in this case, we use haptic feedback from the seat that I just showed you to notify the driver to please take back control of the vehicle. And at the moment, we are building this full-size driving simulator, as you can see here in one of our labs at UCL. So we have a vehicle from a Japanese manufacturer. Here we have Alex and Ismail, who are graduates from mechanical engineering, who have helped to integrate the steering wheel with feedback, the vision, as you can see here. This was also in collaboration with a company called Ansible Motion. And so we have this available now at UCL, and we are integrating currently our seat into the vehicle to do a number of tests. So as I said, I'm at the moment in the new lab, so we had to come to a new location. And now I would like to show you quickly the new lab, and maybe you can also see, I'm just gonna delete my background. So you can see now the new location is in this lab at UCL. So this is a brand new lab space that a professor, Nick Tyler, from civil engineering built, and our driving simulator, part of our driving simulator, can be seen exactly there. And the car is just around the corner. So we are just in the process to rebuild our driving simulator in this lab space for this to do our tests very, very soon. So coming to the end, I would like to also mention that We will organize the biggest robotics conference, in fact, in 2023. So if you should decide to come to UCL to be interested in robotics, you're very, very welcome to help organizing this event, which will take place between 29th of May and 2nd of June 2023. And 5,000 to 6,000 roboticists around the world are expected to participate, and you can then engage with all of them and see what type of robotics they are doing. I would like to thank, of course, my team that has been doing all the research that I have been showing today, and the funders that have kindly provided the financial support in doing this research. So I went a little bit over time maybe, but we have now a good 15 minutes to go through some questions and answers. Thank you very much. So I'm just going to stop my screen here. I'm going to the questions and answers. And the first question was already from who asked how data science, machine learning, and artificial intelligence will help in robotics. And that's a very good question. Thank you very much for that. In fact, all of these actuators and sensors are generating a vast amount of data. And this is a very good opportunity for artificial intelligence and machine learning to look into this data and classify the data and then help with, for example, modeling a certain robotic device. And for instance, some of the robots that I have shown in the videos are extremely complex themselves. They're working in complex environments, extreme environments. And using machine learning can help, in fact, to deploy these devices and model these devices to control the devices. So the machine learning and artificial intelligence, so data science, data analytics, is extremely important in robotics and robotic applications. Then we have another question, if I can recommend any books or resources for soft robotics. Soft robotics is a very new field, a very young field. I'm not aware of any specific books here at the moment. However, if you go to Google and you put in Scholar, then you will end up on a website called Google Scholar. And if you put in soft robotics, you will have access to papers that researchers have written around the world. And there's one interesting paper from a professor, Daniela Roos, who kind of wrote a review on designing and controlling soft robots. So you might want to look at that. Maybe I hope you will find it. Otherwise, please drop me an email and I will guide you to the right paper. And I hope you will then enjoy reading this. The next question is from a human. A human can 2.5 million gigabytes. What robot can store the most information and how much can it store? So I think that there is a lot of technology development in terms of storing data. And researchers have been very successful to store more and more data on smaller devices. So you can maybe remember 10 years ago, we had hard disk drives that were very bulky, heavy, and also very sensitive to shock. So this has all moved now to SSD drives, for instance, that can store a lot of more data. But at the same time, there is also a tendency to use data that is in the cloud. So researchers are moving, how can communication be quicker between and be offline, or not offline, but does not be need to be stored on a robotic device, but it can be stored somewhere else. And then through communication, so for example, 5G, there can be real-time communication happening, so that in fact, robotic devices do not need to store them right physically on the system. There's a question from, may I ask some suggestions on books? Yes, of course. And if there are other online resources for people from non-STEM subjects but interested in robotics, please do email me. I mentioned one source earlier on, but please do email me and I will come back to you. Generally in robotics, there are books that are written, for example, by Bruno Siciliano on robotics and control. And I found that very helpful, that book, when I started studying and looking into that, into the discipline of robotics. So that might help as well. But please feel free to email me and I will have a look, and hopefully am I able to share more resources on that. Then another question, I asked, what qualities would one have to be successful in robotics? I think if you are an engineer, then you have the capability to understand a problem, a real world problem, make the right assumptions to then model it mathematically and analytically, and then be creative to suggest solutions to overcome challenges. And I think this creativity, as well as analytical thinking, is good for any engineering discipline. And that would also then benefit if you like to do robotics. So let's go to the next question. It's about, is it true that the number of jobs that robots create are more than the number of people robots make redundant? So that's a very good question and very difficult question to answer. I tried to mention in my slides that, of course, robots are usually deployed when it is too dangerous to humans to do the job, or when these jobs do not want to be done anymore by humans because they are repetitive, they are monotone, etc. So in this case, then robots are coming in to do the job that humans do not want to do anymore, or that humans it's too dangerous for humans to essentially do these jobs. The next question is about when would you expect level 5 self-driving cars will be on the market? I think some of these vehicles are on the market. They are called maybe pods or shuttles. They drive, though, on predefined trajectories at a very low speed. At walking speed, let's say. They're not much for the road. But if you look into commercial available vehicles that we can all have to go from A to B, I think that this will possibly not happen in my lifetime. I believe that there will always be the need for drivers who can take control in situations that the car will not manage. If you think, for instance, that robots have to, in a way, obey some rules. So if my home is, or the destination is at the end of a road, which is only accessible if I go in the wrong direction, then the level 5 autonomous cars will never go there because it should not go in that direction. So you can see that there will be hardly a large number of journeys, so I mean from start to end, that can be done fully autonomous. I believe that journeys always need a certain intervention from humans. So making any predictions, I think, would be, I would only be wrong there. Could triboelectric nanogenerators one day be used to consistently power a robot? I'm not sure I have heard ever triboelectronic nanogenerator, so I'm not very familiar to, not in the position to answer that question. Maybe you can come back to me in an email about that. Is the Vine robot an example of soft robot? What materials compress when the air pressure in them increase to make the Vine robot move left and right? That's a very good question. The Vine robot was originally, I think, proposed by Professor Alison Okamura and Elliot Hawkes at Stanford University. So it's an inversion robot where the robot extends its is elongated through the inside through feeding material through the inner channel. And I'm myself have not looked into the Vine robot myself, but of course I can imagine how navigation is happening, and some navigation is happening because pouches can be added at the outside of this robot that can be actuated. And when these pouches are actuated, they bend certain segments of the Vine robot. What applications of soft robots do you see in the biomedical field? So in the biomedical field, or in the medical field in general, there's a lot of work on manipulators. But in fact, if we look into interventional operations, there is, in the field of cardiovascular engineering, a soft device that is called a balloon catheter. And this balloon catheter is, in fact, a soft device, but it's not robotic because it's manually actuated. So this is for sure a soft medical device. And we, in my lab, we are working on using this device as a sensing device. So we want to retrieve some data from there and then help the clinician in the decision-making process, for instance. So I think that there can be a lot more done, but of course there are also other fields, for example, in endoscopy or colonoscopy, where for early detection of cancer, and these procedures are very unpleasant at the moment. And I think because they're hard devices, or devices that are made out of rigid materials, are used, and I believe that this could also be a good field for soft robotics to have a positive impact on. I'm not sure if I misunderstood, but is the haptic feedback to alert or wake up the driver if needed? That's absolutely, you can phrase it like this. It is there to intuitively guide the driver to take back control. Will autonomous vehicles ever be completely self? I'm sure that there are policies and safety regulations that will prevent unsafe vehicles on our road. And if there's evidence that these systems are not safe, they will not be allowed. So I believe that we will only see them on our roads, and we will be able to use them if safety is, of course, guaranteed. Does the knowledge of programming help mechanical students in the field of robotics? Yes, absolutely. I think there is some level of programming required for any engineering discipline, not only computer science, because we live in a world where a lot of challenges are mathematically described using software. And these software require, in some cases, some programming skills that will help you to understand and solve problems. So I think it is very important that you will be able to program in any engineering discipline. So I think that we're coming to the end of this session. There are quite a few open questions still. I'm very happy to answer some of them in detail if you email me. I would like to hand over back to Michael at this point. Yes.
Hi, thank you so much, Dr. Wurdemann. Do you want to state what your email address is, or we could send that out to all the people who've signed up today, if you would like. It's just a shame we don't have more time, but it's fantastic to see the enthusiasm and the many interesting and challenging questions which you've come up with. If there are more spring into STEM lectures that you're interested in, do visit the website to have a look at those. And if you've missed some of the talks, they will be available on the UCL Engineering YouTube channel. So just left for me to thank Dr. Wurdemann for his wonderful talk. Thank you for your wonderful questions. And also to thank you for, if you didn't ask any questions and you just participated and got something out of it, then thank you for attending. So look out if you want to catch up on what was said before, you missed the detail, the recording will be available. So thank you very much, and take care.
Thank you. Bye now.